Baptist Church Bible study on this Tuesday evening. Amen. And it's good to be here. It's good to hear all the ice over there in the ice machine. And I tell you, I'm glad this isn't a professional broadcast. Amen. Yeah, right. All right, let's go to the Lord in the word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, once again, we thank you for watching over us today, bringing us home safely. Lord, putting a hedge of protection around us and our vehicles. Lord, the men at work. And Lord, I thank you that we can get up every morning and use the restroom and do all these things, Lord, on our own right now. And as we get older, Lord, we appreciate that more and more. Lord, pray for those that don't have that ability anymore. Lord, I pray for Danny Mallory. I pray you touch his body and heal him. I hope he's doing well. And Lord, Rush Limbaugh and his cancer. And Lord, I pray for President Trump. Lord, I know we don't deserve President Trump for 4 more years. Lord, I know that we've sinned against thee. Lord, this country has sat by and watched people murder babies in the abortion clinic. Lord, husbands and fathers that fathered these children would march their wife or girlfriend, if they weren't married, they'd march them down to a building and pay a so-called doctor, but really a butcher, to murder their own seed. And Lord, these mothers, Lord, it used to be that the womb was the safest place in the whole wide world, that a mother would give her life to save the fruit of her body. Instead, Lord, as the verse says, the fruit of our body for the sin of our soul. And Lord, us that have tried to do nothing about it, and thank God for those that will get out there and march against this murder. Lord, we thank you for them, but Lord, there's so many of us that just sat around and let it go by. And we're just as guilty. And so I pray that you'd forgive us. And Lord, this nation has done wickedly. They offered their children up to Baal. And Lord, we ask you to forgive us. And Lord, I pray that in spite of our sin as a nation, our ungodliness, Lord, our separation, Lord, from you, and yet saying we know you, I pray that you just have mercy on us. And Lord, that if President Bush or President Trump will do in the last 4 years, Lord, as he did in the first 4, Lord, we'd appreciate it, even though we don't deserve it as a nation. And we'll thank you for that. Lord, forgive me for the slip of the tongue to say Bush. I'm starting to sound like Biden. Lord, we don't want to go that way. So I pray that you just watch over us, keep us, and help this country get back on the right path, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would foil the plans of the Democrats, and Lord, that you would deal with them and manifest their devilish deeds, and we'll thank you for it. For it's in the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ we pray. Lord, we ask you to be with us tonight as we study thy word. In Jesus' name we pray and ask these things. Amen. All right. Well, good evening to everyone that is there. We still have the some others that are having a meeting at their church in Pleasant Valley, Pennsylvania. Amen. And so keep them in prayer. And the Nigerian fella I told you about the other night, pray for him. I just texted him, found out that he was getting his load off over in Greenville, North Carolina. And I hope that he can get back home in time to still keep his new account that he's just got. So pray for him. His name is David Chica. All right, let's see who we got here. Ronnie Goen.
Drive the nails in my hands,
Amen. Seems strange not seeing my sisters on there the last couple nights, but they'll be back Thursday.
Aunt Vivian's on.
Vivian's on. I don't see her on mine. Mm. Amen.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storm of God is here assail, by the word and word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord. Bound to Him, no time I leave, I love strong cord. Overgrowing daily with with the Spirit's sword, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fall. Listen, have a moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Amazing. All right. Oh, boy. Another long day. Tell you what. There's one thing that's never been fixed. That is stupid. Oh, the phone calls today. Amen. Anyway, it's good to be here tonight, and we're going to start in chapter 12 of Hebrews. We got two more chapters, and we'll be finished with that book of Hebrews. Amen? All right. He says in verse 1, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses." And you saw the witnesses in chapter 11. Not that they are witnessing us, but we were witnessing them. And all that they suffered and all that they went through, amen, to please God. They fought a good fight. They warred a good warfare. Now that's why it says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin." You know, I believe that the average Baptist today, the independent Baptist, the professing Christian, they haven't resisted unto blood, striving against sin. It's more like they just throw their hands up and surrender. Amen. They don't even try. "And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth." Do you know what? God is going to chasten and scourge everyone that gets born again. He's got to do that to try to get some of the world out of us. Amen. You look what happened to the Israel when they came out of Egypt, a type of the world. They had to wander in the wilderness, try to get the world off of them. They had to go through some trials and tribulations, amen, to prove them. And when you get born again, there's some trials and tribulations that you're going to go through. And he says in verse 7, "If you endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if you be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers." He says, "Then are you bastards and not sons." He said, you're professing to be someone you're not. You're not a child of the Father if there's no chastening in your life. "Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh who corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure. But he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness." And that's the whole purpose of chastening, is to make us a partaker of his holiness. And there's people that will rebel against that chastening. And yeah, they're saved. But you know what they're going to face? They're going to face the sin unto death of the believer. They're going to face the Lord at the judgment seat of Christ. And he says, now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. You know, when I was raising my children, the Bible says that we're to chasten them. Amen? We're to correct them. Otherwise, what you're going to have is what we have on the streets of Philadelphia and Portland and everywhere else, a bunch of tantrum crying, bunch of rebellious children in adult bodies. Amen. I noticed that when I chastened my children, that they would be upset, they'd get chastened. But you know what they would do? They would run to me, not from me. They would run to me, and they would crawl up in my lap when they were little, or they hug me. Amen. Now, someone else's child, if I was to chasten them, they're not going to run up to me. Amen. They're going to run away. And you know, the Christian, when he gets chastened, and he knows when it's God chastening him, he's not going to run away from the Father. He's going to run to him. That's where he's going to find his comfort. And you know what it does afterwards? It yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Follow peace with all men, and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person, as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For you know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. For ye are not come unto the mount that might be touched, and that burned with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of the trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated, that the word should not be spoken to them any more. That's when Moses came off the mountain, his face showing by the glory of God after he'd been with him all that time. And the mount burned with fire, and they weren't to touch it. Amen. And there was a tempest and all, and they were afraid of it because they wanted Moses to cover his face. In verse 20, it says, for they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a dart. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. He says, but ye are come unto Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. Abel offered up lamb's blood. Jesus offered up God's blood, his own. See that you refuse not him that speaketh. For they escaped not who refused him that spake on earth. Much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. Has the Lord dealt with your heart? Has the Lord called you? You know, if the Lord's called you and you've rejected and ran away, you know what? He might never call you again. Could you imagine that? What you would give up for eternal life? To go to a place full of flames and suffering and pain? because you wanted to hang on to your sin, because you didn't want to obey God, because you didn't want to come to Him, the Mount Zion. Think of what people are going to suffer. I sit there, sometimes I just sit and meditate and think about what hell is like for some of my loved ones that have already died and went there. Some of my friends that already died and went to hell. What they're going through at this moment. And if they could, they would just turn now. But it's too late. They wanted to satisfy their flesh and to live their life of sin. And they rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. One of my best friends, we drove truck together, we ran together, two man. We partied together, we did all that. You know, when I got saved and I tried to preach to him, he didn't want to hear it. Like I said before, he'd come into town, stay at the truck stop and sleep in his truck rather than come over and stay at the house. He wouldn't even stop in to see me anymore. Why? Because every time he came by, his conscience had to be pricked because he knew what I was. And now he saw what I am. And you know what happened to that man? He kept on in his rebellious way. And as far as I know, he's in hell tonight. His name was Fred Davis. And he was on his way on it. He was going to his truck to go out on town on a trip and had a heart attack and died right there. My heart ached for him. I prayed for him. I wanted to see him saved, but you can't force anybody to be saved. He didn't want nothing to do with it. You know why? He loved his sex life. He loved his sin. And he wouldn't repent. It's a sad thing. He says in verse 25, "See that you refuse not him that speaketh. For if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. Whose voice then shook the earth. But now he hath promised, saying, Yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace, whereby we may serve God acceptably, with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire." Chapter 13, verse 1, last chapter of the book of Hebrews. "Let brotherly love continue. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares." Think about that. Some have entertained angels unaware. Angels are not women with wings. They're men. They look like any other man. We see that account in Genesis when they came to Sodom and Gomorrah to destroy them for their wickedness. And he says that we ought to not be forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. There's some people you've met that you've entertained that possibly might have been angels. I've had a couple experiences like that. He said, "Remember them that are in bonds as bound with them, and them which suffer adversity as being yourselves also in the body." He says, "Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers, God will judge. Let your conversation," that's not your talk, that's your walk, "let your conversation be without covetousness. And be content with such things as you have, for he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. So that we may boldly say, The Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever." He says, "Be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines. For it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace, not with meats which have not profited them that have been occupied therein. It says we have an altar whereof they have no right to eat that serve the tabernacle. For the bodies of those beasts whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin are burned without the camp. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered without the gate. They took him outside of Jerusalem and hung him on a cross on Mount Calvary. He says, let us go forth, therefore, unto him without the camp, bearing his reproach. For here have we no continuing city, but we seek one to come. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But to do good and to communicate, forget not. For with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. He says, obey them that have the rule over you, and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls, as they that must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. God is going to hold me accountable for the things that I taught and the people that he put under me as far as in the church, and I'm going to have to give an account. Pray for us that we trust we have a good conscience in all things, willing to live honestly. But I beseech you the rather to do this, that I may be restored to you the sooner. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation, for I have written a letter unto you in few words. Know ye that our brother Timothy is set at liberty, with whom, if he come shortly, I will see you. Salute all them that have the rule over you, and all the saints. They of Italy salute you. Grace be with you all. Amen. Written to the Hebrews from Italy by Timothy. It was Paul's book. Timothy penned it for him. You know, we look back over in chapter 12, and he talks about that root of bitterness in verse 15. He says, looking diligently, lest any man follow the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. You know, I saw that verse. I was going through a tough time at one time because of the church and some things in it. Got discouraged, and I got bitter. And you know what it did? It affected the people around me. Some never recovered from it. And I saw that one day, and I said, I want to dig that root up. You know, you can cut it off at ground level, but that thing will sprout back up. He said, how do you know if you got a root of bitterness? Well, if you had something to do with somebody and you were upset with them, and you say, well, I'm going to forgive them, but I ain't going to forget. That's not getting rid of that root of bitterness. And the other thing is this, when somebody says something good about that person that you're jealous of or that did you some harm and it just eats you up inside, you still got that root of bitterness. Amen. I see a lot of people carry that root and their whole life is really miserable and they destroy the people around them. But you look what they went through in chapter 11. That's why Paul says in chapter 12, verse 1, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be weary and faint in your minds. You have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. We're in a race and we're in a war, a spiritual war. And you know, it's been said by some people that the Lord filled my cup and ain't nothing come out of it and nothing more went in it. And somebody said, well, that sounds like a bunch of tadpoles in there. See, God expects us to keep moving. And if we're not moving forward, we're falling behind. Amen. We need to stay busy for the Lord. I hear so many people all the time say, well, I love the Lord. The Lord's been good to me. They play the religion game. They come to church 4 or 5 times a year. Amen. But they're still living in their sin. They don't want to give their sin up for salvation. They don't want to live for God. But yet, when things go wrong, guess who they're crying to? Oh, God. It's like I told you before when I lost that $1,000 in that poker game in Detroit. Oh, God, why'd you let that happen? Amen. How crazy we are when we're lost. We ain't got a lick of sense. Thank God that he didn't give up on us. I hope he don't give up on you if you're lost. And if you're saved, you need to get back in the race, start running again. Not from God, but to him. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for this evening. Lord, thank you for letting us get through the book of Hebrews. And Lord, help us, Lord, to give us leadership and guidance where you'd have us to go next, Lord, whether it be to Leviticus for the sacrifices or the book of Job. Lord, I don't know. But I pray that you'd put it upon my heart in the direction you'd have us to go. Lord, for the folks that are faithfully tuning in and listening. Lord, may you bless them. Lord, I pray for those that couldn't tune in tonight that'll tune in later. Lord, I hope they're having a good meeting at their church. For it's in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray and ask these things. Amen. All right. God.